Hello and welcome to another installment of the Why Football podcast with me, Michael Dryden, and Eches Adogwu. Today, we'll be taking a look at the 2022 World Cup in Qatar, the bidding process, allegations of corruption, migrant deaths, and we'll discuss whether the tournament will go ahead. Before we start, please follow us on Twitter at @WhyFootball_ and subscribe with us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, Acast, and YouTube. So, Eches, how are you?
Yeah, not too bad, thanks. As I say that every single week. And a positive spin, I went to the shop this morning, and you know when you see someone's, like, it's so windy outside, I just saw someone's plastic carrier bag just going away in the wind and they were trying to chase it. So that was quite mean, but I found that quite funny. So, yeah, I don't know.
How is that linked to how are you? Is that how
it's just I'm in a good mood because it made me laugh. So it's like, what? You look at Tesco's carrier bag. It's like, why do you need? Like, it's gone. Except it's gone. It's not coming back to you.
Fair enough. I can't argue that, Chiz. I can't argue at all.
Anyway, Jordan, how are you doing? You okay?
Yeah, not too bad. Again, nothing's going on. I haven't left the house, so I've seen a Tesco in about 6 months. So, you know, at least you beat me to that. But yeah, no. Sunderland are at Wembley tomorrow. You know, I love mentioning Sunderland, but we're at Wembley in the Papa John's Trophy final, the Peter Cup. So that will be interesting. Pretty pointless cup. But, you know, a victory at Wembley, you know, you can't sniff at that, can you?
Yeah, you guys have a very tough time at Wembley, don't you?
Last six visits, six defeats.
That's nice.
That's good, isn't it? Yeah.
At least you turned up. That's a positive.
So, Eches, moving on to today's topic, why the Qatar World Cup?
So, you know, the World Cup's the pinnacle for all football fans. You know, people travel across the globe to see. We initially wanted to go to this World Cup, but obviously we may not, depending on reasons I'm going to mention later on. There's been so many great spectacles over the years. You know, there's been Korea and Japan, which is a really funny World Cup because the World Cup final was on the day I got had my first Holy Communion. So I was meant to have my first Holy Communion with 12 children. And in the end, I had it with one other person because everyone else moved it to the earlier one so they could see the World Cup final. My dad pleaded with my mum for her to move it to the earlier one. She said no. So I had a church that was completely empty apart from my family and his family. And that was it, really.
Yeah, mate, God doesn't stop for the World Cup final, does it?
He doesn't, no. So that was quite funny. Obviously, Brazil won that one with the famous Ronaldo haircut. South Africa one was brilliant for Africa, being the first country to host it in the continent, which was brilliant. You know, he had the Shabalala goal with the guys dancing in the opening game, which is memorable.
The Vuvuzelas, I couldn't get away with them. I know I'm like a millionth and one person to say that, but it was so irritating. Like, I know it was like it was a massive celebration of culture and stuff, but listening to that during the games was actually just like, and then hearing Rooney after the Algeria game just like, you know, these Vuvuzelas like ringing in the background, and then Rooney's just like shouting into the camera, our own fans are booing us. I was like, that was a low for English football.
Yeah, you sound like you'd be quite fun at a party, Dryden, to be honest. You sound like a pretty fun guy.
Invite me. But,
yeah, I'll think about it, mate. but that World Cup was memorable as well. And then 2014, I believe Germany were the first winners. I think that's the first World Cup won by a team not from that continent.
I believe so.
Nah, you know what? I'm not too sure about that.
It does make sense. I mean, I can't think of an example. I mean, Euro. No,
I think it's the first Euro winner. No, let me correct it. I think it's the first Euro winner to not win in their own continent.
But what about 94? So Brazil won in, I mean, that's still what I mean. Continent,
that's,
isn't it?
Yeah, is it? And that's no, what I mean.
North America and South America, yeah.
Yeah, and I feel like 58, Brazil was in Sweden or somewhere where they won it.
I think given the amount of times Brazil have won it, and the fact that it's...
I think it's a European team. I'm going to stick with that one. Anyone that wants to fire shots at me.
Well, it's the only European winner to...
Not win in their own continent.
Yeah, that's fair enough. All right, I'll give you that.
Yeah, thank you very much. Anyone else wants to fire at me, my Twitter is Edoku Etches. Is that my Instagram? It doesn't really matter.
I don't know.
We'll move on swiftly. So those are some great World Cups in the past, and Qatar is the next installment in 2022, which has been filled with lots of controversy right from when it was announced. You know, it'll be the first Arab nation to host it, which is a huge achievement. So I wanted to do a podcast and looking at how the bid was won, the issues that have been raised since, and whether they're kind of are even deeper issues rooted within FIFA itself.
Yeah, I think we're all aware of those issues, and we'll go on to it. The biggest surprise of all, I mean, the size of Qatar. I mean, before the World Cup was announced there, I mean, before we discussed going there because we're not getting any younger, and yeah, but Qatar is just marginally bigger than London. You know, there's a population of 2.8 million, which I'm doing some maths this morning, is around roughly half the population of Scotland. So you've got to think, you know, compare that to US and Mexico, like the landmass and Mexico. So it's US, Mexico and Canada, sorry, where the 2026 World Cup is going to be held. I think compare the landmass that is split across compared to Qatar, you know, the infrastructure around that and the stadiums and stuff. I mean, it's just crazy, really, that such what is effectively the biggest sporting event in the world has been held in a country that is the size of a capital city and has a population of, you know, of a capital city. I mean, London has a population of 12 million. So wow. It's crazy, really. So it's just kind of these overriding questions here. We'll go on to it. You know, was it purely about money? And I mean, what was the World Cup supposed to be like, right? I mean, you know, we talk about the size of the country, we talk about the money involved, but, you know, where is a World Cup supposed to be? You know, is the UK something like that? Is that a preferred location with the infrastructure already there, the history? But if that was the case, the World Cup would just go around the same 6-7 countries and we'd never see it anywhere.
Yeah, true. Yeah, the World Cup definitely has to expand. But the burning question I really have for you is, when you were working out the population of Qatar, did you use a calculator to work that one out? Because I know your maths, as you've realised in earlier pods, is sketchy at best.
Yeah, so what I did was I worked out the population of Qatar. I worked out the population of Scotland. It took me a while, but I worked out that it's about roughly half.
Okay, good. Congratulations then.
Thanks.
I was a bit concerned you're doing some sort of long subtraction, which I think you struggle with. So we'll move on and leave that one there. Cheers. My mind's at ease. So I thought I'd do a little bit on how World Cup bids actually, how they actually work, because I think often you just see live on Sky News, they've just announced the tournament and then you're like, okay, fine, this is where it's going to be. Unless if your country's involved in it. So, you know, sometimes you're aware that England are involved in the bid, like we were for 2018. So you're a bit more engaged. But when it's not your country, you just kind of switch on the channel and you're like, oh, here we go. That's the World Cup bid. So the way it actually works is the FIFA Executive Committee vote to decide where each... where they should host the tournament, which is to no surprise. It's like a multiple round ballot system used to determine the host. So all of the eligible members of the FIFA Executive Committee have one vote each. The country that receives the fewest votes is eliminated, which obviously makes sense. And then the majority then basically wins. If there's a tie, the FIFA president has the overriding vote, which used to be Sepp Blatter, who was obviously corrupt. Yeah. So that's a lot there.
Yeah. Yeah, that sounds foolproof.
Yeah, exactly. Corrupt Sepp Blatter at the helm. The process goes as follows. Applications are formally invited, so you can send in your application. There's a closing date for registering an intention to bid. Then there's a deadline to submit a completed bid. Then a deadline for the full details of the submission. Then an individual application inspection begins and ends. So delegates will go to where you're going to host it, because obviously
I bet they do. Just imagine, like, in Qatar, the whole committee just with Andy Gray and Richard Keys around this big steakhouse in the middle.
Well, the thing is, I'll get onto Qatar in a bit, because Qatar had so much construction to do for the World Cup. So I did kind of think, what are you really inspecting? So I'll go on to what they're going to introduce later on. But yeah, obviously for somewhere like England for the 2018 World Cup, they wouldn't have built anything, because obviously we've got the infrastructure and stadiums. There may have been changes to things like maybe bus routes and fan mobility. But generally speaking, you know, it's pretty straightforward. And then after that, after the inspection, FIFA then announce the winners.
This kind of format, you've got the executive committee who are obviously... essentially deciding who the tournament goes to. I don't know what that committee is made up of. I mean, we had it's obviously quite a variety of different backgrounds and nationalities who are part of that. But then, I mean, if you give the vote to nations or FAs, so if say every nation had a vote, I mean, every nation that's involved now is quite a lot. If you think about the qualification stage, that would be a bit manic. And it would get incredibly political. I mean, it'd be like the Eurovision Song Contest for the World Cup.
Yes, that's a really good point. So let's move on to the teams that actually applied for the 2022 World Cup. We have Australia, who launched a bid for the 2018 World Cup but withdrew. Their 2022 bid and 2018 bid was launched by a guy called Ben Buckley. Who is Ben Buckley, Dryden?
He's a famous ballroom dancer in Australia.
He was a former NRL player.
Makes
in
sense.
In Australia. You got Quinton Bryce.
Gonna go cricket this time.
She's a governor. She's a governor.
I'm just thinking of Quinton Fortune.
Fair play. Hold tight, Quinton. Oh, he was a passenger. Anyway, the final one is Ella McPherson.
Ella McPherson. She's a female footballer. Famous former female footballer.
former model and part-time actress.
Quite the array there.
Yeah, exactly. But despite the star-studded cast to present. Also, hold on as well. Where's Tim Cahill?
That's true. Where is Tim?
Where's Tim?
He's too busy. He's too busy on... What's he on? He's BBC, isn't he? No, he's part of the BBC lineup. Yeah. You know, he needs to pull his finger out because, you know, where is Tim? Where's the rest of the lads? Where's Harry? Where's Harry Kewell? Mark Duke.
Yeah, they missed out some big guys. But yeah, despite the star-studded cast to present the bids, they ended at rock bottom in the bidding process with one vote that apparently shocked analysts and people in FIFA. But the issues around getting access to stadiums for sports used in the NRL and AFL, which clashed with the World Cup. Next was Japan. The issue that they had was them and South Korea hosted it in 2022, which was said to work against them. They came fourth. South Korea also bidded. They came third. Same issues with Japan as they previously hosted it. And the final one was the USA, who came second. They had a strong bid, but they lost to Qatar.
Yeah, I mean, getting back to the point before, I mean, it makes you think, like, I mean, what makes a good... what makes a good host country, but also what makes a good World Cup bid? I actually have very little idea. You'd assume it would be, we assume like a good candidate for a World Cup would be one that already has infrastructure. There's a fan base there that are going to flood stadiums. You've got an infrastructure around it in terms of transport. But I suppose, you know, is that actually beneficial for FIFA to have that? I don't necessarily think it is. I mean, people in England and the UK often make out we would be an ideal location in England, for example, because we have that infrastructure. But as I mentioned before, I mean, if that was the case, we'd just be rotating around the leagues. But then obviously rotating around kind of the developed footballing nations, like pretty much Europe's top five leagues. But then when you give it to like someone like Qatar, so much work is needed.
Exactly.
So it's kind of like a balancing act, I suppose. Like there would be, because if it went to England, you just know that people would complain, or certain nations would complain that it's just like elitist. It's just like giving it to, you know, Premier League's the biggest and kind of most lucrative league in the world. It would just be allegations of, you know, it's just going to them for those reasons.
Yeah, it's a difficult one to kind of answer. Indeed. Yeah, you want the World Cup to go across the globe, but as you said, there's so much infrastructure that's needed to do it. You know, as time goes on, we can't be in 2100 and then England have hosted three World Cups, Brazil have hosted five World Cups, and then Germany have hosted four World Cups. It's not really a World Cup, but, you know, there is the argument as well as how many countries can actually afford to do so and do so safely. I think South Africa showed that, you know, it's possible, and Qatar, hopefully, will win a tournament. Yeah. Australia, as a matter of time, if they keep on bidding to get the World Cup down there, I think, you know, there's other countries in Africa as well. I know Morocco and Algeria have bidded a few times, or Morocco in particular has, so maybe they'll get it one day, and then, you know, there's other countries as well. But yeah, there's not too many nations that can feasibly host it. I think what we'll see is more multiple country bids. I think that's best way to get around it. So, you know, Nigeria may team up with Ghana, or Morocco may team up with somewhere else, because I think all in one country to get the infrastructure and stadiums is pretty tricky. So moving on to, so we discussed how, you know, World Cup bids and football heritage and whether, you know, World Cup should be in certain countries and whether it should go to developing nations. I wanted to then focus on issues with Qatar's actual World Cup win. So one of the glaring issues with World Cup in Qatar is the heat. I've been to Dubai. I've been to Dubai in the summer, and it's like 50 degrees, and you know, Qatar is very similar. So yeah. Qatar's answer, I have to take a pause here, for how they're going to control the heat in the summer, was to have air-controlled stadiums to combat the heat with other tricks up their sleeve if that wasn't viable. You can't... Other tricks up their sleeve if that wasn't viable is a direct quote. What?
Well, they've already moved the date. Maybe they can move it to, like, you know, another location as well.
They can't inspect the stadium and you're like, whoa, don't worry about it, lads. You've got other tricks up our sleeve. Don't you worry. It's like, it doesn't work that way. You have to provide some information, a bit more clarity as to what that is.
Yeah.
Something so rigorous and meticulous in planning, you know, in terms of the inspection, you know, the bids. I'm sure the bids aren't, we're going to host the final in Wembley and that's it. You know, there'll be so much information on where fans will stay, transport, communication, and they've just put some aircon on, I reckon. That'll do.
Yeah, but it's a good point, because you mentioned it earlier, like, what are they inspecting though? Like, they're inspecting, like, there's a promise of all this stuff is going to be built, this infrastructure, these hotels, these stadiums. So what are you inspecting? I mean, there must be, I assume there's already infrastructure there and that's what they're inspecting. You know, can these airports deal with it currently? What is needed? There must be, I assume anyway, there is infrastructure in terms of sports already there. So perhaps that, but I just can't get this picture out of my head of, you know, Platini and the rest of the lads in Qatar with Keys and Gray around a big table in a bar, just sinking some pints. That's what I think.
some premium Guinness. But as we know, they then moved the World Cup to the Winter Edition, which caused a lot of issues with a variety of nations complaining about it clashing with the Winter Olympics, as well as it affecting local leagues like the Prem and Bundesliga.
Yeah.
Franz Beckenbauer, a member of FIFA's executive committee, said Qatar could only be allowed to host the 2022 World Cup in the winter. He justified the proposals on the grounds that Qatar would be saving money, which it otherwise would have spent in cooling stadiums. It's like, what? Well, why'd you award it to them then?
Yeah,
like,
it's a known fact. You can't just say, oh, they won it fair and square, so you got to give them a chance. Well, they won it on the basis it's going to be, they bid to host an event that had a fixed date.
Yeah, it's like they just didn't know. It's like, oh, it's quite hot today. Is it usually like this? it's often a bit cooler than today, but, you know, it'll be fine for the World Cup. Don't worry about it. Like, what? It doesn't matter. It doesn't make sense. Beckenbauer actually said, one should think of another solution. In January and February, you have a comfortable 25-degree temperature there. Qatar won the vote and deserves a fair chance to host it in the Middle East. Yeah, that's perfectly fine. I'm not saying that the Middle East shouldn't host the World Cup, but why was it not highlighted as an issue, or why wasn't it pitched that way? You know, they could easily have said, we'd like to host it in the winter. You can't win it and then be like, yeah, you know what? We were thinking, and yeah, it's not really possible in the summer, you know? You can't do that.
Yeah, we're thinking about moving it to Western Europe instead. You know, we're going to host it in Norway.
I mean, we're still... it is pretty mad, but there you go.
But yeah, I mean, to that point, I mean, there is an argument that, like, you know, it is often a summer tournament, and, you know, not even just the Middle East. I mean, there's obviously, you know, a lot of areas of the world where it would be really difficult to host a tournament in the summer because it's too hot. And so there's an argument there of, well, do we just exclude regions for that region? But for that reason, but, you know, as to your point, yeah, it should be in the bid. Like, you know, fair enough. Countries in, I mean, there's countries in Africa, for example, I mean, a lot of countries in Africa, the other countries in the Middle East and other parts of the world where conditions aren't ideal for a tournament at certain times of the year, but it needs to be part of the bid. I just find that a bit mad.
So moving on to the next bit, I thought I'd look at migrant deaths, which is quite a sad point. So something which has been highlighted frequently has been the safety of migrant workers helping construct or build infrastructure for the World Cup in Qatar. Since they've been awarded the hosting rights for the football's biggest tournament, 6,500 migrant workers from 5 countries, mainly in South Asia, have died.
Yeah.
The Guardian noted deaths among workers from countries like India, Pakistan, Nepal, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka between 2011 and late 2020, with an average of 12 dying each week during that period. The migrants there are said to be held against their will. So once they go, they can't leave as their passports are held by Equatorial officials. So they work there until basically they don't need them anymore. Apparently the true death toll is likely to be significantly higher as deaths from other countries aren't factored in. You know, Qatar itself is heavily reliant on migrant workers. The majority tend to come voluntarily from Asia and parts of Africa. And for this World Cup bid, you know, there's been so much infrastructure needed. So I mentioned this earlier, I don't want to say, but they needed 7 stadiums, a new airport, as well as broad additions to its public transportation network. So it's a huge, huge project.
Yeah, it's a massive deal.
But the US State Department has said that the conditions that workers are facing there is terrible in terms of the labor violations are taking form from forms of beating, sexual assault, restriction of freedom, as I mentioned, withholding their passports, as well as withholding of salaries. So it's really, really terrible, terrible conditions for these people to work in, which is honestly unacceptable.
Yeah.
But this isn't new for Qatar, which raises questions as to why the World Cup was actually given to them. You know, they've had labor violations for years, long before the World Cup was even given to them. And it's been highlighted by loads of human rights organizations, yet the World Cup was still given to them. You know, if you look at it from the outset, we've got a nation which is riddled with structural issues, which has caused the World Cup to move to winter. It's a huge project in terms of infrastructure. You've mentioned how FIFA, you know, have given the World Cup to them, and that's fine. But it just seems there's so many negatives working against them compared to the people it bid it against. You know, we've got, I know America have hosted it, Japan and South Korea, but what about Australia? You know, it seems as if something's missing as to why Qatar got this bid. You know, why have they managed to get it when there's so many things stacking against them? And sadly, it seems that corruption has played a part in that.
Yeah, I recall listening, this is about a year ago, I recall listening to the Ornstein and Chapman podcast from The Athletic. That's not a plug, as we're not part of the network, but, you know, we're happy to be if they fancy it. They made a point that FIFA often always started, particularly with South Africa onwards, awarding tournaments to nations that require that huge infrastructure. So you think in South Africa, a lot of stadiums were built, so you would have needed the airports and the infrastructure around it, the hotels to be built. In Brazil, you know, there was already existing football infrastructure, but around that there was work needed in terms of, you know, transport and hotels again. And then Qatar, it's a huge infrastructure project because you're building a lot of this from scratch. I mean, you've got hotels there existing and airport structure, for example, but you don't have the football infrastructure. Almost all the stadiums, I think they said in that podcast that around 12 stadiums is kind of the optimal amount that is required for a tournament like this, and they've built most of them from scratch. And one of the reasons why, or a prevailing reason why it goes to these nations and goes to a nation that needs to build all these things is because it generates construction contracts. So that'll benefit FIFA potentially if they're involved in the sale of those contracts or involved in a slice of it. And it'll definitely benefit the nation or the investors within it. So, you know, the owners of large construction firms, etc. And it's almost like a political reason to build a lot of these things. So why would, for example, Qatar, I mean, there's a lot of human rights violations, so you could argue that they're not overly that concerned about what, you know, the human element and what their population think. But how can you get away with building a lot of infrastructure and generate a lot of money for people? Well, you know, a World Cup's a great excuse, isn't it? I don't think anyone was surprised, but I think that's just a really sad fact, isn't it? No one was surprised. I remember it was years ago now that Russia and Qatar were awarded the World Cup. So it feels like a lifetime ago. And it felt like Qatar was so far away. And now we're approaching, what, almost a year until that is going to go ahead. And are we surprised that it went there still? No, I don't think we are. And I think we've become less surprised over time as these allegations of migrant death workers, 6,500 people have died at the hands of this as a result of this tournament, essentially. So it's just crazy. Like, it's absolutely just, in what other context is that acceptable?
It's astonishing. And, you know, it's sad, really, that it's got to this point where FIFA kind of looking beyond the human right issues and the flaws and just looking at it purely from a money perspective. I mean, the allegations of corruption in FIFA are well documented, which within itself could be a pod, but back in 2011, the allegations of corruption over then Vice President Jack Warner, email was saying that Qatar bought the World Cup through bribery via Mohammed bin Hammam, who was the president of the Asian Football Federation. Asian Football Confederation got there in the end, just well about. So that was denied by both parties. Again, in 2014, apparently Qatar's successful campaign paid Jack Warner and his family almost $2 million. So Jack Warner is heavily implicated in that. Then in 2019, more allegations arose in January where Bonita Mazzeri-Diaz, a whistleblower from the Inside Australia's 2022 World Cup bid, published a book which alleged that in the months before the vote in December 2010, executives basically agreed a deal where Al Jazeera paid $100 million if... Al Jazeera, sorry, Al Jazeera now BEI in sports, which is home to our two favourites, Andy Gray and Richard Keys. They're not our favourites, they're actually very bad people, but they work for BEI in sports.
Yeah, just clarify that. I mentioned them twice, but I don't actually, they're very good people.
But they agreed a secret deal to pay $100 million if Qatar won the vote. That actual allegation led to Michel Platini, the former UEFA boss, being arrested on charges of corruption. But moving on, I kind of want to discuss whether, you know, the tournament will actually go ahead. And the reason why I said that is because Norway have become the first national team looking to boycott it due to health and safety concerns for workers. You know, the corruption amounting and the allegations have left really bad taste in the mouth of many for this tournament. And there's so much pressure, like South Africa, actually, for the tournament to be a success in terms of, you know, it being the first Arab nation to host it. And just loads of issues around it in terms of the migrant deaths and the corruption around it. And it's a really delicate situation for footballers, right? Because Norway aren't going to win the World Cup, shock horror. They've got some good players. They've got Erdengard, they've got Haaland. They've got the guy at Leipzig, who's at Palace, Schorloff. They've got some good players, but they're not going to win it. But, no, you know, the issue is around what Norway represent, you know? If we start having 6, 7, 8 minnows pull out, they have to be filled by other countries, and then you could get a void in the World Cup of Nations doing so. And what happens if individual sportsmen don't want to do it? We have some great footballers around the world that care about social issues. We've got Marcus Rashford in this country. I know Mesut Ozil was once very involved with migrants in Turkey previously before as well. And there's loads of footballers who do loads of things. I can't list them all. But what if you have one in particular that has a very keen interest in what's going on there? Let's say Mbappe, someone of his stature that decides, he's won a World Cup. So he could then say, you know what, I don't fancy going to the World Cup because of X. That has huge say. In terms of marketing, in terms of player power, in terms of pool, that is a big, big worry and a concern if players start doing that as well as countries. So I think that the situation is extremely delicate. Yeah, the tournament's obviously going to go ahead, but it's a very delicate situation because I think Norway have announced it just at the right time and it's waiting for a player of stature to say, I don't fancy it. And then we could really see a couple of issues arise for the hosts there.
Yeah, it's so difficult because the people with the power and the ability to change, it's just as you said, it is actually the players and the footballing authorities. You know, if they decide to pull England out, that's a big deal. But at the same time, I mean, those players, those authorities, I mean, they don't want to do that because obviously for a player, it's a pinnacle of their career to play the World Cup. They only get so many. You know, they weren't involved in the process. So I think they would feel aggrieved that they're missing out on that experience, on that. So it can be beneficial for their career. I mean, how many players on the back of a World Cup get moves, big money moves, salary increases? Yep. It's huge for footballers. And so, you know, it's I think FIFA know that though. FIFA know that the players, if the players had a kind of, if it was less implications for players around, you know, their brands, their sponsorship, their careers, then FIFA might be more kind of cognizant of the players and of their interests and of how it affects them, because then if they were to do, as you say, pull out, then that would affect them. So there'd be a risk there. But they know there's no risk because they know, you know, the chances of someone like Mbappe pulling out is still very low. He has sponsorship deals with, you know, numerous organizations, and for them, his value in terms of sponsorship and marketing and the brand in the world is, you know, largely due to the fact he will go to a World Cup, the biggest sporting event in the world. It's not the only reason, but it's a big factor that he will represent France in the World Cup. And it's just, so I mean, that's what I was talking about earlier. There's so many forces entwined with this where it's so interconnected with all these different factors.
Yeah, I think football's problem is that it sees itself in its own bubble, right? So kind of like the Zlatan Ibrahimovic versus LeBron James issue where Zlatan was like, LeBron James should just stick to basketball.
Yeah.
And it's kind of this case in football where football sees themselves as, this is the game, this is what's happening. Everything else around it doesn't matter as long as football's going on. Mm. And, you know, that's quite a negative way to look at it because football can impact so many people in so many different ways. And it's a shame, as you rightly pointed out, that we're in a situation now where it's kind of seen as like, Mbappe can close his ears, can't he? And a lot of these ballers can and say, you know what, I'm here to do what I need to do for my career, but not really looking at the bigger picture as to what it really represents. And yeah, you are right. It would be a shame if it doesn't go ahead. And what more can you do? It's really an issue from FIFA, and you can't have any trust in FIFA because they all seem corrupt. So obviously there's someone, I can't remember his name now, who's taken over from Blatter, who said he's going to change loads of stuff, and you are skeptical. I know Wenger's involved there as well, and Wenger's a legend, so hopefully it resolves itself. But the level of corruption when I was doing research for this pod was so deep and so wide that you are skeptical whether they're looking for the best interests in the game or they're looking for, you know, payouts and what benefits football in terms of money, whether it's, as you said, having massive infrastructure because they benefit through sponsorship and money in that sense. And that's kind of the situation where we're at. The tournament will definitely go ahead, but whether it's the right thing to do, I'm not so sure.
Yeah, it's Gianni Infantino, as you're thinking of, as the current FIFA president. And I think part of his election promises was to rid corruption, but obviously that's always going to be the headline, and whether it actually happens is another factor. And I mean, what you mentioned earlier is bang on. Like, you know, think about COVID, think about the project restart. Like, it was such a priority to get the Premier League back on our screens, but when you think about it, is a bit bonkers during a pandemic for that to be the case, putting people at risk. But again, you've got all this money involved, all these sponsorship contracts, everything that goes around it, and that's what causes this to happen. And it's good because we're football fans, but it's also bad because people, you know, people are at risk in different ways. Right, well, that's all from us this week. Thank you so much, Etches, for the research on that, which is a fascinating topic. We could have done a 3-hour pod, never mind a 30-minute pod on that. I'd love to expand that in terms of South Africa and even just further beyond, right? So where we're going into next in terms of the USA, Mexico and Canada, I think that'd be fascinating topics. But yep, thank you all for listening, guys. Please continue to subscribe with us on all our platforms, and we'll see you again next time.
Cheers, guys.
Thank you.